Part 1. The Doctrine of High Magic. Beyond the veil of all the hieratic and mystical allegories of the ancient doctrines, beyond the shadows and strange trials of all initiations, under the seal of all sacred writings, in the ruins of Nineveh or of Thebes, on the eroded stones of the ancient temples, and upon the darkened sides of the sphinxes of Assyria or of Egypt, in the marvelous or monstrous paintings which express the sacred pages of the Vedas for Indian believers, in the strange symbols and hour books on alchemy, in the initiatory ceremonies practiced by all mystery cults, we find the traces of a doctrine which is the same everywhere, and everywhere is carefully hidden. Occult philosophy seems to have been the wet nurse or the godmother for all religions, the secret lever of all intellectual powers, the key to all divine enigmas, and the absolute queen of society in the eras in which it was reserved exclusively for the education of priests and kings. She reigned in Persia among the mages, who one day perished, as do perish the masters of the world, for having abused their power. She endowed India with the most amazing traditions and an incredible poetic treasure, with grace and terror in its symbols. She civilized Greece with the sounds of Orpheus's lyre. She hid the principles of all the sciences and of all the progress of the human spirit in the audacious calculations of Pythagoras. Myths were full of her miracles, and history, when it attempted to consider this unknown power, fused with mythology. She shook or strengthened empires through her oracles, made tyrants turn pale upon their thrones, and dominated minds through curiosity or fear. "For this science," said the masses, "nothing is impossible. She commands the elements, knows the language of the celestial bodies, and directs the progress of the stars. The dead rise in their tombs and articulate with fatal words the wind of the night that whistles in their skulls. Mistress of love or hate, the occult science can, according to its desires, produce paradise or hell in the human heart. She disposes at her leisure of all forms and allots, as she so desires, either beauty or ugliness. She changes, in turns, with the magical wand of Circe, men into brutes and animals into men. She even has at her command both life and death, and can confer riches upon her adepts through the transmutation of metals, and immortality through her quintessence and through her elixir, which is composed of gold and of light. That is what magic was, from Zoroaster to Manes, from Orpheus to Apollonius of Tanea, until positivist Christianity, triumphing at last with the pleasant reveries and the elephantine aspirations of the school of Alexandria, dared to publicly strike down that philosophy to which it was anathema, and thus reduced it to being even more occult and mysterious than ever. Thus, Christianity did not owe any hatred to magic, but human ignorance has always been afraid of the unknown. Occult science was obliged to hide in order to avoid the passionate aggressions of a blind love. She covered herself with new hieroglyphs, concealed her efforts, disguised her hopes. Thus, she created the jargon of alchemy, a continual deception for the vulgar transmutation of gold, and a living language only for the true disciples of Hermes. What a remarkable thing! The original alliance between Christianity and the science of the mages, if it is properly demonstrated for once, would not be a discovery of mediocre importance. And we doubt not that the result of a serious study of magic and the Kabbalah would bring serious minds to a reconciliation, until now regarded as impossible, between science and doctrine, and between reason and faith. We have said that the Church, whose special characteristic is that of repository of the keys, does not pretend to have those to the Book of Revelation or the visions of Ezekiel. For Christians, and in their opinion, the scientific and magical keys of Solomon are lost. Nonetheless, it is certain that in the domain of intelligence governed by the verb, nothing which is written is lost. Things of which men cease to have knowledge of only stop existing for them, at least as verbs. They enter then into the domain of enigmas and mysteries. Indeed, the antipathy and even the open war of the official church against all that deals with the domain of magic, which is like a personal and emancipated priesthood, is due to causes which are necessary and even inherent to the social and hierarchical constitution of the Christian priesthood. The church ignores magic because it must ignore it or perish. As we shall prove later on, it also does not recognize that its mysterious founder was greeted in his crib by the three mages. That is to say, by the hieratic ambassadors from the three parts of the known world and from the three analogical worlds of occult philosophy. Here, take this book, read the seventh page, then sit down upon this coat which I shall lay down, and we will roll back the coverings before our eyes. Your head is turning, is it not, and you feel as if the earth is fleeing from beneath your feet. Hold firm, and do not look. The vertigo stops. We are there. Stand up and open your eyes, but do not allow yourself to make any Christian sign or pronounce any Christian word. We are in a landscape by Salvator Rosa. It is a troubled desert which seems to be coming to rest after a storm. The moon no longer appears in the sky, but do you not see little stars dancing in the heath? Do you not hear flying about you gigantic birds who seem in passing to be murmuring strange words? Let us approach in silence that crossroad among the rocks. A husky and funereal trumpet is heard. Black torches are lit from all sides. A tumultuous assembly presses about an empty chair. They look and they wait. All of a sudden, everyone prostrates themselves, and they murmur, "There he is! There he is! It is him!" A prince with the head of a goat arrives in leaping strides. He sits upon the throne. He turns and presents a human figurine to the assembly while bending down, to which then everyone heads with black votive candles in hand to give it a greeting and a kiss. Then the prince rises with a strident laugh and distributes gold, secret instructions, occult medicines, and poisons to his acolytes. All the while, fires are being lit. Alderwood and ferns are being burnt pell-mell along with human bones and the fat from torture victims. Druidesses with golden sickles, wearing crowns of smallage and vervain, sacrifice children stolen before their baptism and prepare a horrific banquet. The tables are set. Masked men sit beside half-nude women, and we begin the Bacchanalia feast. Nothing is missing except salt, which is the symbol of wisdom and of immortality. The wine flows like water and leaves stains resembling blood. The speech is obscene, and the wild caresses begin. Now the entire assembly is drunk with wine, with crimes, with lust, and with song. We rise in disorder, and we run to form infernal round dances. Then come all the monsters of legend, all the ghosts of nightmares. Enormous toads put flutes to their lips the wrong way and blow while pressing their sides with their legs. Limping beetles join the dance. Crayfish play the castanets, and crocodiles play upon their scaly skins like harps. Elephants and mammoths arrive dressed as cupids and raise their legs as they dance. Then the frenzied round dances break up and disperse. Each male dancer carries off a screaming, wild-haired female. The lamps and candles made of human tallow go out and are left smoking in the shadows. We hear cries here and there, outbreaks of laughter, blasphemies, and rough breathing. Come, wake up. I have brought you back home, and you are in your bed. You are a bit tired, a bit broken even from your voyage and your night. But you have seen a thing of which everyone speaks without knowing of it. You are initiated into the terrible secrets like those in the cave of Trophonius. You have witnessed the witch's Sabbath. More real and even more truly, you must simply avoid going insane. Keep up a healthy fear for the law and stay a respectful distance from the church and its burning stakes. What is happening in the world? And why do priests and kings tremble? What secret power menaces the tiaras and the crowns? Here are a few madmen who run from country to country and who hide, they say, the philosopher's stone beneath the tatters of their poverty. They can change earth into gold, yet they lack shelter and bread. What is this magic, then? What was the power of these overly persecuted and proud men? Why, if they were so strong, were they not victorious over their enemies? Why, if they were foolish and weak, did we give them the honor of fearing them so much? Is there a magic? Is there an occult science which is a veritable power and which works wonders, capable of competing with the miracles of the authorized religions? To these two important questions we answer with a word and with a book. The book will be the justification of the word. And here is that word. Yes. Yes, there existed, and there still exists, a powerful and real magic. Yes, what all the legends said about it were true. In this case only, and contrary to what ordinarily happens, popular exaggerations were not simply off track, but less than the reality. Yes, there exists a formidable secret whose revelation has already overturned the world, as the religious traditions of Egypt attest, symbolically summarized by Moses at the start of Genesis. This secret forms the fatal science of good and evil, and its result, when it is divulged, is death. Moses symbolizes it as a tree which is at the center of the terrestrial paradise, and which is near, which even embraces with its roots the tree of life. The four mysterious rivers have their source at the foot of this tree, which is guarded by the sword of fire and by the four forms of the biblical Sphinx, Ezekiel's cherubim. Here, I must stop. I am afraid I have already said too much. Yes, there exists a unique doctrine, universal, imperishable, strong as supreme reason, simple as all that is great, intelligible as all that is universal, and absolutely true. And this doctrine was the father of all others. Also exists in nature a force much more powerful than steam. With its use, a single man could seize it and direct it, could disrupt and change the face of the world. This force was known to the ancients. It consists of a universal agent whose supreme law is balance and whose control is directly related to the great arcanum of transcendental magic. Through the control of this agent, we can even change the order of the seasons, produce daytime phenomena at night, communicate instantly from one end of the world to another, see, like Apollonius, what is happening on the other side of the world, heal or strike at a distance, give speech a real impact and a universal effect. This agent, which just barely revealed itself with the fumbling of Mesmer's disciples, is precisely what the adepts of the Middle Ages called the raw material of the great work, and it was that which they adored in their secret rites of the Sabbath or of the temple, under the hieroglyphic figure of Baphomet or of the androgynous goat of Mendes. All this shall be demonstrated. Yes, there exists a science that confers upon man, apparently, superhuman prerogatives. Here now are the privileges and powers of he who holds the key of Shlomo, in his right hand and in his left the blossoming almond tree branch. Aleph. He sees God face to face without dying, and speaks casually with the seven spirits who command the entire celestial army. Bait. He is above all afflictions and all fears. Gimel, he reigns with all of heaven and is served by all of hell. Dalid, he has health in his life at his command, as well as the life of others. Hey, he can neither be surprised by misfortune nor struck down by disasters, nor vanquished by his enemies. Vav, he knows the reason for the past, the present, and the future. Zion, he has the secret of the resurrection of the dead and the key to immortality. Those are the seven great privileges. Here are those which come afterward. Chet, to find the philosopher's stone. Tet, to have the universal medicine. Yud, to know the laws of perpetual movement and to be able to demonstrate them with the squaring of a circle. Kaf, to change not only all metals into gold, but also the earth itself, and even the refuse of the earth. Lamed, to tame the most ferocious animals and know the words to say which numb and charm serpents. Mem, to master the well-known art which produces universal science. Nun, to speak knowledgeably about all things without preparation or study. Here at last are the seven minor powers of the mage. Samech, to know at first sight the depths of men's souls and the mysteries of women's hearts. Ayin, to force nature to surrender to him when he desires. Pe, to predict all future events which do not rely on a superior free will or an imperceptible cause. Zadik, to be able to immediately provide the most effective consolations and all the most advantageous pieces of advice. Huf, to triumph over adversities. Resh, to tame love and hate. Shin, to have the secret to riches, to always be the master over them and never the slave. To know how to take pleasure even from poverty and to never fall into abjection or misery. And finally, Tav, let us add to these three septenaries that the wise man governs the elements, that he calms storms, that he heals the sick by touching them, and that he raises the dead. But there are things which Solomon sealed up with his triple seal. The initiates know, and that suffices. As to others, whether they laugh or believe, or doubt or threaten or be fearful, what matter is it to science and to us? The philosopher's stone, the universal medicine, the transmutation of metals, the squaring of the circle, and the secret of perpetual movement are neither scientific hoaxes nor wild dreams. They are terms that must be understood in their true sense and express all the different uses of the same secret, the different characteristics of the same operation, that we define in a more general manner by simply calling it the Great Work.
Thank you.
The great work is, above all else, the creation of man by himself. That is to say, the full and entire conquest of his faculties and his future. It is, above all, the perfect emancipation of his will, which assures him the universal empire of Alzoth and the domain of Magnesia, which means full control over the universal magical agent. To reach the sanctum regnum, that is to say, the science and the power of the mages, there are four things which are required. An intelligence enlightened by study. An audacity which nothing can stop. A will which nothing can break. And a discretion that nothing can corrupt or intoxicate. To know, to dare, to will, to be silent. Those are the four verbs of the mage, which are written in the four symbolic forms of the Sphinx. These four verbs can be combined together in four ways and can be explained four times through the others. On the first page of the Book of Hermes, the adept is depicted wearing a large hat, which, if he lowers it, could hide his entire head. He holds one hand up towards the sky, which he seems to be commanding with his wand, and the other hand on his chest. He has before him the principal symbols or instruments of science, and he hides others in an illusionist's satchel. His body and his arms form the letter Aleph, the first of the alphabet, which the Hebrews borrowed from the Egyptians, but we will be coming back to this symbol again later. The mage is actually what the Hebrew Kabbalists called the micropersopus, that is to say, the creator of the little world. The first magical science, and also the first of all the works of science, was knowledge of oneself. It is that which contains all the others, and which is the principle of the great work. It is the creation of oneself. This word needs to be explained. The supreme reason, being the only invariable principle, and in consequence imperishable, since change is what we call death, intelligence, which adheres strongly to, and in a certain way relates to this principle, is thus also invariably, and therefore immortal. We understand that to adhere invariably to reason, one must have become independent from all the forces which produce, through their fatal and necessary movement, the alternatives of life and death. To know how to suffer, abstain, and die. These are the first secrets that raise us above pain, sensual desires, and the fear of the void. The man who looks for and finds a glorious death has faith in immortality, and all of humanity believes in it with him and for him, because humanity raises altars or statues of him as a sign of immortal life. Man only becomes king of the animals by subjugating or taming them. Otherwise, he will be their victim or their slave. Animals represent our passions. They are the instinctive forces of nature. The world is a battlefield where liberty battles with the force of inertia by using the active force. The physical laws are the millstone, and you will be the grain if you do not know how to be the miller. You are called to be the king of the air, of water, of the earth, and of fire. But to reign over these four symbolic animals, you must conquer them and place them in chains. He who aspires to become a sage and to know the great mystery of nature must be the heir and the despoiler of the Sphinx. He must have a human head to possess speech, the wings of an eagle to conquer the heights, the body of a bull to plow the depths, and the claws of a lion to make space for himself to the left and the right, in front and behind. You, who wish to be an initiate, are you as wise as Faust? Are you as imperturbable as Job? That is not so, is it? But you can become so if you wish. Have you conquered the whirlwinds of vague thoughts? Are you decisive and not capricious? Do you only accept pleasure when you want it? And do you want it only when you should? That is not so, is it? It has never been so, has it? But it could be so, if you wish. What a strange thing. The seven doors of Thebes, defended and attacked by the seven leaders who have sworn upon the blood of their victims, have the same meaning as the seven seals of the sacred book accounted for by seven spirits, and attacked by a seven-headed monster after having been opened by a living and immolated lamb in the allegorical book of St. John. The mysterious origin of Oedipus, whom we find suspended like a bloody fruit from a tree on Mount Cithaeron, recalls the symbols of Moses in the tales of Genesis. He fights against his father and kills him without knowing him. Dreadful prophecy of the blind emancipation of reason without science. And then he arrives before the Sphinx. The Sphinx, symbol of symbols. Eternal enigma for the vulgar, the granite pedestal of the science of the sages, the devouring and silent monster who expresses, by its invariable form, the unique doctrine of the great universal mystery. How does the quaternary become the duality? And how is it explained by the ternary? In other more illustrative and vulgar terms, what animal is on 4 feet in the morning, 2 at noon, and 3 in the evening? Philosophically speaking, how does the doctrine of the elemental forces produce the duality of Zoroaster? And how is it summarized by the triad of Pythagoras and Plato? What is the final reason for the allegories and the numbers, the last word of all symbolism? Oedipus answers with a simple and terrible word which kills the Sphinx and which will have him become the perspicacious king of Thebes. The word for the enigma is man. If Oedipus, instead of killing the Sphinx, had tamed it and harnessed it to his chariot in order to enter Thebes, he would have been a king free of incest, free of calamity, and free of exile. If Psyche, by dint of submissions and caresses, had gotten Love to reveal himself, she would never have lost him. Love is one of the mythological images of the great secret and the great agent because he expresses both an action and a passion, a void and a plenitude, an arrow, and a wound. Initiates should understand me, and due to the profane, one cannot speak too much about it. One had in those times to make up for miracles by having them appear to be superstition, and make up for occult science by having it written in an unintelligible language. They resuscitated hieroglyphic writing, and they invented pentacles and characters which summarized an entire doctrine in a sign, a whole series of tendencies and revelations in a word. What was the goal of aspirants to the science? They were searching for the secret of the great work, or the philosopher's stone, or perpetual movement, or the universal medicine, expressions which often saved them from persecution and hatred by having themselves labeled as madmen, in which all expressed one of the aspects of the great magical secret, as we shall demonstrate later. We have just rapidly sketched out the history of occult philosophy. We have pointed out the sources and analyzed, in but a few words, the principal books. This work does not deal only with science. Magic, or rather magical power, is composed of two things, a science and a force. Without force, science is nothing, or rather is in danger. To take science only by force, such is the supreme law of the initiations. Without a doubt, since we are trying to explain the Philosopher's Stone, perpetual movement, the secret of the great work, and the universal medicine, we will be accused of madness, like the divine Paracelsus, or of charlatanism, like the great and unfortunate Agrippa. Even though Urban Grando's burning stake is extinguished, there remain the nameless prescriptions of silence or of slander. We do not seek them, but we are resigned to them. We do not look to have this work published on our own, and we believe that if the time has come to speak, the words will come of their own, from us or from others. Thus we shall remain calm, and we shall wait. Our work is divided into two parts. In one, we establish the Kabbalistic and magical doctrine in its entirety. The other is dedicated to the cult, that is to say, ceremonial magic. One is what the ancients called a clavicule. The other is what country people still call a grimoire. The number and the subject of the chapters, which correspond between the two parts, are anything but arbitrary, and are all found indicated in the universal key for which we give for the first time a complete and satisfactory explanation. May this work now go where it wishes and become what Providence desires of it. It is done, and we believe it to be durable because it is as strong as all that is reasonable and conscientious. Magic is only appropriate for kings and for priests. Are you priests? Are you kings? The calling of magic is not a vulgar calling, and its royalty has nothing to do with the princes of this world. The kings of science are the priests of truth, and their reign is hidden from the multitude, as are their sacrifices and their prayers. The kings of science are those who know the truth, and the truth has set them free. Thank you. One who is a slave to his passions or to the prejudices of this world will not know how to become an initiate. He will never be able to do so as long as he does not reform himself. And so he will not know how to become an adept, because the word adept means he who succeeded by his will and through his works. One who loves his ideas and is afraid to lose them, who is suspicious of new truths and is not disposed to doubt everything rather than accept something at random, he can close this book, which is useless and dangerous to him. He will understand it poorly and will be troubled by it, but he would be even more troubled if by chance he were to understand it better. If you hold something dearer in this world than reason, the truth, and justice, if your will is uncertain and faltering, either for good or for evil, if logic frightens you, if the naked truth makes you blush, if your feelings are hurt when your errors are touched upon, throw this book away at once, and then act, in not reading it, as if it did not exist for you. But do not denounce it as dangerous. The secrets it reveals will only be understood by a small number, and those who understand will not reveal them. Showing the light to birds of the night is like hiding it from them, because it blinds them and becomes for them more obscure than darkness. I will thus speak clearly. I will tell all, and I have the firm belief that only initiates, or those worthy of being initiates, will read everything and understand something. There is a true and a false science, a divine magic, and a magic that is infernal. That is to say, misleading and obscure. We will reveal one and unveil the other. We will distinguish the magician from the sorcerer and the adept from the charlatan. The magician disposes of a force which he knows. The sorcerer struggles to abuse that of which he is ignorant. The devil, if it can be permitted to use this reviled and vulgar word in a book of science, surrenders himself to the magician, and the sorcerer surrenders himself to the devil. The magician is the sovereign pontiff of nature. The sorcerer is but its desecrator. Before going further, let us clearly define magic. Magic is the traditional science of the secrets of nature, which comes to us from the mages. By using this science, the adept is invested with a sort of relative omnipotence and can act in a superhuman manner. That is to say, in a manner which is not within the common reach of men. It is in this manner that several famous adepts, such as Hermes Trismegistus, Osiris, Orpheus, Apollonius of Tyana, and others, which it could be dangerous or inconvenient to name, were adored or invoked after their death as gods. It is in this manner that others, following the flux and reflux of opinion, which makes for the vagaries of success, became the henchmen of hell or dubious adventurers, like the Emperor Julian, Apuleius, Merlin the Enchanter, and the arch-sorcerer, as the illustrious and miserable Cornelius Agrippa was called in his time. Thank you. When a certain philosopher took as the basis for a new revelation of human knowledge the following reasoning, I think, therefore I am, he changed in a way, and without his realizing it, the ancient concept of the supreme being according to Christian revelation. Descartes has man say, I am he who thinks. And because thinking is to speak internally, Descartes' man can say, I am he within whom and by whom is expressed the verb. What is a principle? It is a basis for speech. Being is the principle. The word is the means, and plenitude, or development, and the perfection of being, is the end. To speak is to create. But to say, I think, therefore I exist, is to assume the consequent of the principle, and recent objections raised by a great writer have sufficiently proven the philosophical imperfection of this method. I am, therefore, something exists, seems to us a more primal and simple basis for experimental philosophy. I am, therefore, being exists. Ego sum qui sum. Ehie eshir ehie, or being is being. Thus, the principle behind this philosophy is what is, and there is nothing hypothetical or uncertain about it. Mercurius Trismegistus began his admirable symbol known by the name of the Emerald Tablet with this triple affirmation. True, without error, certain, and most true. Thus the truth is confirmed by experience in physics. Certitude is freedom from any alloy of falsehood through philosophy. Absolute truth is arrived at by analogy in the domain of religion or the infinite. Those are the primary requirements of the true science. And it is that which magic alone can provide to its adepts. But before anything else, who are you? You who hold this book between your hands and are beginning to read it. On the pediment of the temple, which antiquity had dedicated to the God of Light, we read the following two-word inscription, Know thyself. I have the same recommendation to give anyone who wishes to come closer to science. All Hermetic science is contained in the doctrine that Hermes originally engraved, or so it is said, on the Tablet of Emerald. We have already described the first articles. Here are those which have to do with the great work. You shall separate earth from fire, the subtle from the coarse, carefully and with much labor. It ascends from the earth to heaven, then descends again to earth, and receives the power of the superiors and the inferiors. Thus you shall have the glory of the entire world, and all obscurity shall flee before you. It is the strong fortitude of all fortitudes, vanquishing every subtle and penetrating every solid. Thus the world was created. Separate the subtle from the coarse in the first operation, which is entirely done from within, is to liberate one's soul from all prejudice and vice, which is done with the use of the philosophical salt, that is to say, wisdom, and with mercury, that is to say, with one's own skill and work, and finally with sulfur, which represents the vital energy and the heat of the will. By these means, we are able to transform less precious things, even the filth of the earth, into spiritual gold. It is in this manner that one must understand the unwashed parables of the philosophers, of Bernard Trevisan and of Basilius Valentinius, of Mary the Egyptian, and other prophets of alchemy, but in their works, as in the great work, one must carefully separate the subtle from the coarse, the mystic from the positive, the allegory from the theory. If we wish to read them with pleasure and intelligence, one must first understand them entirely allegorically, and then descend from the allegories to reality by the path of correspondences or analogies indicated by the unique doctrine which states, that which is above is like that which is below, and vice versa. backwards, or read in the manner of the sacred and primordial writings, that is to say, from right to left, expresses with three initials the different degrees of the great work. The letter T signifies ternary, theory, and travail. The letter R, realization. And the letter A, adaptation. Here for our readers, for the purpose of research, the admirable treatise attributed to Hermes Trismegistus, entitled Minerva Mundi. This treatise is found in only a few publications of Hermes, and contains, in the form of allegories, with much poetry and profundity, the doctrine of the creation of beings by and of themselves, or the law of creation which results from the accordance of two forces, the forces the alchemists call the fixed and the volatile, and which are in the absolute necessity and liberty. Therein is explained the diversity of forms spread throughout nature by the diversity of spirits, and the monstrosities of nature by the divergence of efforts. The reading of and meditation upon this work is indispensable to all adepts who wish to deepen their understanding of the mysteries of nature and to begin to work more seriously towards the achievement of the great work. When the masters of alchemy said that one needs little time or money to accomplish the great works of science, when they affirm, moreover, that only a single vessel is required, when they speak of the great and unique Athanor, which anyone can put to use, and which is available to everyone, and that men possess it without knowing, they are alluding to philosophical and moral alchemy. In fact, a strong and decided will can arrive at absolute independence rather quickly and repossess the chemical instrument, the great and unique Athanor, which serves to separate the subtle from the coarse and the fixed from the volatile. In this instrument, as complete as the world itself and as precise as mathematics, and that is designated by the sages with the symbol of the pentagram or the five-pointed star, which is the absolute sign of human intelligence, I shall imitate the sages by not naming it. It is very easy to guess it. Thank you. The secret book of ancient initiation was not ignored by Homer, who draws its plan and its main figures on Achilles' shield with exacting precision. But Homer's graceful fictions soon seem to make us forget the simple and abstract truths of the primal revelation. Man takes to the form and forgets the idea. The signs, in multiplying, lose their power. Magic as well, at that time, becomes corrupt and then descends with the witches of Thessaly into the most profane enchantments. And the science of good and evil elevates evil as a sacrilegious divinity. Men, tired of the light, take refuge in the shadow of corporeal substance. And hell is created. The crime of the king of Thebes is not to have understood the Sphinx. It is to have destroyed the bane of Thebes without having been pure enough to complete the expiation in the name of his people. Soon after, a plague takes revenge for the death of the Sphinx, and the king of Thebes, forced to abdicate, sacrifices himself to the terrible spirit of the monster, which is more alive and more devouring than ever. Now that it has passed from the domain of form into that of idea, Oedipus had seen what man is, and he puts out his eyes so as not to see what God is. He had divulged half of the great magical arcanum, and to save his people, he must carry within himself into exile and into the grave the other half of this terrible secret. After the colossal myth of Oedipus, we find the graceful poem of Psyche, of which Apuleius is certainly not the inventor. The great magical arcanum reappears here in the symbol of mystical union between a god and a feeble mortal, abandoned, alone, and naked on a rock. Psyche must be unaware of the secret of her ideal kingship, and if she looks at her husband, she loses him. Apuleius here comments on and interprets the allegories of Moses. But did not the Elohim of Israel and the gods of Apuleius also come from the sanctuaries of Memphis and Thebes? Psyche is the sister of Eve, or rather, she is Eve, spiritualized. Both of them wish to know and lose their innocence in order to gain the honor of a trial. Both of them are worthy of descending into the hells, one to bring back Pandora's ancient box, the other to search for and crush the head of the ancient serpent, which is the symbol of time and of evil. Both of them commit a crime which must be expiated by the Prometheus of ancient times and the Lucifer of Christian legend. One is liberated, the other is subdued by Hercules and by the Savior. The great magical secret is thus Psyche's lamp and dagger. It is Eve's apple. It is the sacred fire revealed by Prometheus. It is Lucifer's burning scepter. But it is also the holy cross of the Redeemer. To know this well enough in order to abuse it or divulge it is to merit every type of torture. To know it as one should know it, to use it and to hide it, is to be master of the absolute. All is enclosed in one word, and in one word of four letters. It is the Tetragrammaton of the Hebrews, the Azoth of the Alchemists, the Thoth of the Bohemians, and the Tarot of the Kabbalists. This word, expressed in so many ways, means God to the profane, signifies man for the philosophers, and gives adepts the last word of the human sciences and the key to divine power. But only he alone who understands the necessity of never revealing it knows how to use it. Thank you.
Let me know.